I'm Piers Sellers, NASA astronaut. I'm a spacewalker and I flew on two missions, STS-112 and STS-121, both to the International Space Station. STS-112, the first mission I was on, we went to space station as part of an assembly sequence and we brought up the S-1, the starboard one truss, and put it on space station and brought it up to speed with three spacewalks. And STS-121 in July 2006 was the second return to flight shuttle mission where we took Discovery up and helped demonstrate that the shuttle was good for flight again. The British Interplanetary Society invited me to speak and they organized this event. As part of it, we talked to a lot of school kids, which is always good, and try to turn on the next generation to, you know, the benefits and fun of science and technology.
2 minutes.
The British Interplanetary Society has a long and glorious history, and I think it did a lot to pull together awareness in Britain of the different aspects of spaceflight. When I was a kid, I used to read Spaceflight all the time, and I've been reminded to renew my subscription, which I've let lapse. But this organization, other ones like it, you know, they bring the whole picture together so that you people can understand what's going on in the space business and share in the excitement of it.
Down the corridor, about 68 now. We spent 3 days doing it.
It's been a long time, you know, between the British Interplanetary Society and myself to try and arrange a meeting, many years, and it almost didn't happen today. I found that going down the Mile End Road is actually harder than space travel. and also, I don't think aliens could ever invade London because there's nowhere to park. But we made it, and I'm very glad to be here today. I'm very grateful to BIS for fixing this up and Queen Mary's for hosting it. And I'm great to see all you rowdy people there at the back. And I look forward to seeing some of you in space in the next few years. I'm serious about that. I really do. You guys are exceptional. You guys are exceptional. And exceptional people get the opportunities. So keep your noses to the grindstone. Who wants to be an astronaut? Anybody? How many of you smoke? Okay, smoking astronauts excluded. No ashtrays on Mars. Okay, well today I'm going to talk a little bit about what it's like to be an astronaut and what it's like to do a launch, what it's like to go to space station, a little bit about what it's like to do spacewalks. They work as hard in the core, as you probably heard. And before we show this terrific video that I've stolen from NASA, actually that a friend of mine made on the crew, I'm going to give you a little bit of background to the mission that we were on this summer. STS-121 was launched on the 4th of July this year. We actually had to go and work on a federal holiday. We got no extra pay for it. We were the second return to flight mission. You'll probably remember that we're in the process, using Space Shuttle, of building Space Station, which was targeted to take about 20, 25 launches to do that. And we just started that, and everything was going great when we had the Columbia accident. And at that point, we were grounded because the shuttle wasn't safe. We knew that we were losing foam off the tank, and that could make holes in the wings, and that we'd lose vehicles on re-entry. So we were grounded. And after about 2.5 years, they launched the next mission when they thought they'd fixed the tank, and that was STS-114, the first return to flight mission. And that took off, and everything went fine, except an enormous piece of foam fell off the tank, missed the vehicle, luckily. But, you know, clearly we had more work to do. So they fixed and fixed and fixed. And finally, after another year, our mission, STS-121, went off last summer. Nothing fell off. It was great. The tank was very clean. Everything performed perfectly. Now, by the time we got around to launching, what we were supposed to do with our mission had changed about 3 times. The first thing that drove it was that space station had been kind of neglected since the Columbia crash. There was a lot broken, so we had a lot of repair work to do outside, spacewalks to fix external equipment. The other thing was that everyone wants to do Hubble. And Hubble's going to be launched into an orbit all by itself. And if we're going to do that, we've got to have some means of repairing any damage that we might get during launch. So we tested out two experiments. One was to see if you could work off a long boom platform, if an astronaut could be put on the end of a huge crane. Whoop, someone shut me off. Hey, let's try the other mic. Hello? Oh God, we've gone dead. They're working back there. Can you hear me if I shout a bit louder?
Yeah.
All right, I'll shout a bit louder. It's good? Go to this one. I'm good. Hello? Okay, good. I think it's all back now. It's all back? It's all back now. Good. So the boom, using this long boom as a repair platform for repairing the shuttle, and you'll see that in the video. The other thing we wanted to see is if we could actually repair a broken piece of shuttle wing itself, to see if you could repair it with a special paste and it would survive entry. And you'll see that too. And the last thing was to bring up a whole ton of goods, resupply goods for space station, which was getting very short of everything by the time we arrived. So that's the background. Let's roll the video. Okay, it's launch day, July 4th. Vehicle's on the pad, fully fueled, ready to go. And we get in, and then all the sensible people go at least 3 miles away. This is the vehicle fueled. Here's us coming out of crew quarters after our steak and eggs breakfast. We're all waving little American flags because it's July the 4th, except for Thomas Reiter, the German. He's wearing a little German flag. Maybe it's Independence Day in Germany too, I don't know. Launch control, everyone's getting ready. We're all in there by ourselves. Turbine start up. Ignition. Main engines. Then the solids. And off we go. You're just bouncing around in your chair, rattling around. It's a very, very violent experience. The roll program, the whole shuttle twists. You see how everyone's being trashed around in their seats? It's real work. And we're going straight up at the speed of sound after 45 seconds. Out the front windows, the sky is going from blue to black after about a minute. You are really, really going fast, and it feels like it. You can see how the ship is trying to hunt the guided solution. It's wobbling around. Noise is unbelievable. You are really getting quite a beating inside the cockpit. Okay, the solid rocket boosters are 2 minutes. They start to lose their thrust, and you'll see them drop off. Guys in the cockpit hanging on, pretending to work. Okay, here go the solids. They're tailing off, and we're going to dump them. Boom, off they go. And there goes the shuttle. That was taken by a very brave cameraman sitting on top of the solid rocket booster. There's the two rookies. They made it to orbit after 10 years of training, so they're happy. There goes the tank. We dumped the tank at 8 minutes. Now we're going 5 miles per second around the planet. Around the planet once every 1 hour, 40 minutes. So that's quick. Okay, on day two, we get up early, have our Wheaties, some coffee, and the first thing we do is inspect the skin of the shuttle. We have this 50-foot boom, which we're holding with the arm, with lasers and cameras on the end, and here's the view from that boom. We're looking at the heat protection system, the thermal protection system, and checking for any damage that we might have received during launch. This is the inspection. We look at the nose, look at the underside of the schnoz, check the reaction control system jets there, and here's us looking down at the cockpit, doing an inspection of the upper part of the shuttle too. The only bit we can't really reach is the whole belly using this system. Okay, flight day three, here we are sneaking up on space station. You can see in the back of the shuttle when we return the view, that's the view of space station from shuttle. You can see in the back of the shuttle that shiny Coke can, it's about the size of a small bus, that's the cargo carrier. And forward of that are two white objects, those are spares for the outside of space station. When we get on the space station, we do this pitch around maneuver. We expose our belly at a range of 600 feet to space station so they can photograph the whole of the tiles on the belly to see if there's any damage there. That's Cape Trafalgar in Spain. which just went under while we were doing this. It's very pretty. Here we go, all the way over. At this point, it's a little worrying when you're in the shuttle because you can't see the station. You kind of hope it's going to be where it's supposed to be when you come out of the roll, out of the picture, I mean. And it is, pretty much. There's space station coming up over the tail. We've sped up this sequence for the purpose of excitement and provocation. It looks better. These two guys on space station, Jeff and Pavel, and they're excited because they think they're going to get some fresh food soon. We come up in front of space station. This is again speeded up, but this is kind of maneuver we do. We sneak up in front of space station. Now bear in mind, we're both going 5 miles per second, but we've matched speeds at this point. So our relative velocity is pretty small, about a foot per second or so. And then we sneak in this last approach we do at 1 inch per second, very slow. And within half an inch precision, line up for parking the two vehicles. And Steve, our commander, did a beautiful job. It's just a picture-perfect docking. Look at that. And then we suck the two vehicles together, open the hatches, and there we are. That's Steve there, the driver. Try and stay away from the feedback here. Okay, these guys are congratulating themselves. I don't know why, because they didn't actually do anything during the docking. Anyway, after about half an hour, open the hatches and we come spilling into their nice clean space station. Now look how organized it looks now, because in a later sequence you'll see how we've trashed it. And that was the end of flight day 3, which is docking. And now I'm going to give you a quick video tour of shuttle and station. Here we are, we're going to float down the ladder, head first, because we can. There you go. Down the ladder, past the bathroom, past a couple of people working, and then we're going to go into the airlock of the shuttle and do a quick turn and up through the airlock hatch, and that takes you into space station through the docking port. And look what damage we've done in 24 hours. There's stuff everywhere. People working like crazy. We're moving materials across from the shuttle to station and back again. Now we're through the lab, that's the American lab we've just been in. And now we're coming up on the Russian segment of space station. This is speeded up again. Russian space station's got a kind of Jules Verne feel to it. The colors are pastels. Those are food bins on the floor, all those blue boxes. And Steve decided to do a quick roll here as he went through. For no good reason, as far as I can make out. Just have to make you feel ill. And then we go further back in space station. The whole thing is about as long as a 747 jumbo jet. And we're going to go into the service module, which is like the living quarters, the kitchen and the galley and everything back there in the Russian segment. Now, flight day 4, first order of business with the two girls with the ponytails, the robo chicks, as we call them, was to use the station arm, which is like a big 65-foot crane, and they come in and grab that cargo carrier by that little pin sticking out. And these are expert crane drivers, Lisa and Stephanie, helped by Jeff there. And they pulled it out the back of shuttle, swung it across through space, and then docked it to the bottom of station. Now you can see it docked. And then we can open the hatches and unload it with all supplies for space station. This is a picture of Queen Mary's College from orbit. No, it's Africa. Okay, flight day 5, it's time for EVA. And the first thing you do is breathe pure oxygen and work out on a bike, and that gets the nitrogen out of your blood, which you need to do to avoid getting the bends when you go out in space in a spacesuit. So Mike and I are breathing pure oxygen on these masks, very uncomfortable. Then we get in our suits, another hour or so in our suits breathing pure oxygen, and then they stuff me head first in the airlock, all the tools and bags, then Mike feet first in there, so I'm smelling his feet, into the airlock, and we can't move, we're jammed in there like in a phone booth. And then after another hour, they've let the air out, and I get to crawl out through the hatch, and it's about a 200-mile drop straight down from that hatch as you come out. And you can see us like two little worms there at the bottom left-hand corner, carrying equipment from one end of space station to the other and then to shuttle. And I've got this big foot platform. You can see it attached to me like a big piece of pipe with a foot platform. We're going to use that as part of this experiment to test the boom. Now we'll show you a little cartoon of how this works. We put the foot platform on the boom on the arm, and swing it out. It's 100 foot of pipe altogether on a very bendy little pole, and the two of us guys on the end. And here we are, doing it for real. The thing was bouncing around a little bit, and it was like trying to work on top of a telephone pole. It was, you had to pay attention. And here's the view looking back at the shuttle from the end of the pipe. And I could see all these warm, comfortable people through the windows who had access to a bathroom and food and stuff like that while we're out here. But after we tested out in free space for a while, they maneuvered us into a part of space station where Mike had this special force gauge. And he simulated doing a repair by exerting forces against the space station. He simulated the amount of force he would require to actually do a repair to see if the boom system was rigid enough. And it was. So it looks like we can use this to repair any part of the shuttle while you're flying in space. So that was check one. It worked out. So we've been outside for about 6 hours, and it's time to go back home. The girls fly us back to the payload bay on the arm. We get off, take all the equipment off, and then crawl our way back to the airlock. And after 7.5 hours outside, close the hatch, and it's time for tea. That's the end of a busy day. We've been in the suit for about 10 hours by that time. Here's another picture of the River Thames. No, it's the river, it's the Nile. You can see the Nile Delta at the top there, and there's the Red Sea. It's a beautiful view. This is Stephanie Wilson. She was the load master on the flight. She's an engineer. And her job was to make sure that, besides operating the arm, that all the equipment that we wanted transferred from the cargo carrier to space station got done. So here she is working. And here she is not working. She liked to do acrobatics in zero G when she thought no one was watching. And she likes to do them slowly. It's really easy to move stuff around in zero G. This is a half ton rack that's being moved through a door, just using your fingertips pretty much. And you'll see Stephanie coming back with a big bag. It's about a 100-pound load. And she's just pushing it around with her hands. It's so easy. It's like you're underwater or something. Except more comfortable. Okay, it's flight day 7, and it's time for another EVA. And the girls fire up the arm again. They spent every day operating the arm at least sometime during the orbit. Mike and I are outside, and we lift the spare pump module. This is about a one-ton object. We lift it off its platform on the shuttle. And then Stephanie drove the arm in and grabbed it. You can see her coming down with the arm, and then swung it over to space station, where we bolted it in position on a stowage platform. So that's like a spare tire in case the major pump module breaks. And here's what it looks like when the sun comes up on station. First of all, it's this beautiful gold color. And then it goes to kind of pinks and bronze colors. It all happens in a few seconds. It's very, very quick. And then when the sun comes up full, it's just blinding white. It's so bright that you can't even look at the metal surfaces on station without hurting your eyes. And you close your visor, and that does the job. And here's how you get around. You don't use your feet, you use your hands. And this is a handrail trail on space station. You just follow the handrails and the numbers, and hopefully get where you're going. Now, here we are changing out a really large broken piece of equipment on station. This looks like a piano. It was actually a cable reel that drives the truck up and down the station. We had a lot of problems with this thing. Getting it out, getting the old one attached to shuttle. I was having a devil of a time trying to bolt it back in position on the shuttle. Here's me bolting away. It wouldn't go, and it wouldn't go. And eventually, I had to use a lot of violence and bad language. And it eventually went into place. Meanwhile, Mike is cruising serenely with the new spare, thinking he's glad and he's well out of that. Then he found he couldn't fit it into space station. It would not fit. It wouldn't go in. And we had to take some equipment apart on space station to make it go in. And here's us using a bolt driver. It's like an electric drill, except for driving bolts. I'm setting the stiffness, or the torque, that I want to set the bolts to. Find my bolt, and drive it. And that's how we do things up and undo them on space station, with a little electrical pistol grip tool. So at the end of that, we had fixed the space station at the end of our second spacewalk, and it was back up and running, ready for the assembly. Now, between EVAs, we did EVAs on Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So on Tuesdays and Thursdays, you get to clean your suit, gas it up with oxygen, water, coolant, and change the batteries. And that's it for another day, another 19-hour day. Beautiful views, but you never get a chance to look out the window. Here's us doing some amateur science. It's a water bubble. Yeah, you can just blow it backwards and forwards. Here's a water bubble with an air bubble inside. And it makes a hideously distorting lens which makes my friend Mike look normal. And when you get fed up with your experiments, you can just drink them out of the air. And here's, I think Lisa thought she was a goldfish. She used to like to try and chase her food around the cabin. These are Smarties or M&Ms. And they got, my friends wanted to train me to do this. They just made, it's like being a hamster, you know. Stephanie used to like to kind of wind her way down her food, like a snake, I guess. And she liked to move while she was eating. And Mike liked to spin between courses. And look at that, you can just spin in place. Perfectly comfortable. Now here we are down the Russian end, we're eating Russian food. We got jellied eels and lamb hot pot. Wasn't bad, wasn't bad at all. It was pretty nice food. And here's me doing karaoke. No, not really. After the meal, they were playing a joke on me. Let me sing along. Okay, flight day 9, third spacewalk. Opening the hatch, the usual blinding glare coming up through the floor when you open the hatch, crawling out. And this is the spacewalk where we're going to test our ability to actually repair broken bits of shuttle wing. We deliberately got some wing panels in the lab back in Houston. We'd broken them, like as if they'd had an impact during launch. And we put them in a big box in the back of the shuttle payload bay. And when we got up there for this third EVA, Mike and I opened the box. There are all these broken wind samples. And we tried to repair them using this black gooey putty and spatulas, like big putty knives. I lost one. I'm famous for that now. I launched my own satellite. So we got a bag full of tools, lots and lots of tools, and lots of this black goo. And you'll see in a minute us spreading it onto the broken tiles. And there you see, using a putty knife, spreading it all over. And we repaired two of these samples exactly the way we were supposed to, right temperature, right technique. And the other three, we didn't have much time, so we did them real quick and dirty. And all five samples, when they took them back to the lab and ran an arc jet test, which simulates re-entry, they all passed. They all worked fine. They would have survived an entry. So we can now access any part of the shuttle using the boom, and we can now repair wing panels up to a certain size damage. This is an infrared image of, I think, me, taken by, or my boot, taken by Mike. It's kind of the typical view you get when you're trying to spacewalk and not look at the scenery. Okay, we're done with the spacewalks, we're done with all the transfers, we're done with the repairs. It's time to think about going home, and we're bringing back our cargo carrier, which is full of trash and experimental results that we're taking home. There's the petals closing on space station after we remove the carrier. And the girls pulled it off the station, then they swing it round to put it in the back of the payload bay of the shuttle. Again, they have to get it right within half an inch, just using TV cameras. There's no windows to look out as to do this. They'll be very precise. And so we made them a badge, Robo Chicks, Lisa and Steph. They're phenomenal. They should get a medal for the hard work they did. All right, when we arrived on space station, they were really, really glad to see us. And then we trashed the place. We kept them up late at night playing music and, no, not playing music, I mean, working and stuff. And so they were extremely glad to see us go. We left Thomas Reiter, German astronaut, the first non-Russian, non-American astronaut to stay on space station. We left him behind, deliberately, with his permission. He'll be coming home this Christmas after 6 months on board. And closed the hatch between us, and they closed their hatch, and we're getting ready to undock. And it's tradition that we have a commander and a pilot on board. It's tradition that the pilot gets to do the undock and the fly around. So Mark Kelly is getting all fired up here, looking out the window. He's the guy with the jewelry on the left. Mark K. Diddy, we called him. And you can see the station moving away through his window. And he's controlling shuttle attitude. Here we are, separating from station. Speed it up, I'm sorry. Goes very slowly, just seems to kind of glacially move away. Everyone's working hard at this point. Photos, navigation. Here's Steve, the commander in the blue shirt, and bang, you'll see some jets fire on the nose. When those go off, it sounds like cannons inside the space shuttle. Boom, boom, every time you get a jet fire. We back away from station. There's the Amazon. We're flying over there, and the space station zooming above it. And right now it's about the size of a jumbo jet, the way you see it now, and it's about half the size it'll be. In fact, it'll be a little bit more than double this big when it's finished. And there's the solar arrays, just beautiful, sailing along like a ship. Okay, so after a day of cleaning up on orbit, it's time to think about going home, and Steve practices his landings using a little video game. Whenever we come and see how he's doing, he used to crash it. And just to keep us on our toes, you know. Yes, on the morning of actually coming home, we get back in our pressure suits. This is in case we get a hole during entry and all the air goes out of the cabin. The pressure suits will protect you until you can land. And we've got parachutes and all sorts of other stuff. Finally, we strap in. Got to drink about almost a gallon of water before you come down. Salty water, too. It tastes disgusting. And we start coming in over the Pacific 40 minutes before we land. And outside, as we hit the atmosphere, the cockpit windows glow cherry red. You can see the plasma outside. You don't want to be out there at this point. And we start doing big bank turns over the Pacific to slow down, sinking down through the atmosphere from Mach 25 when we hit the atmosphere. Very, very fast. And finally, we just drop out of the sky like a bomb right over Kennedy Space Center, and there's the runway. Come through the clouds, and Steve is driving along here at 300 knots. Very fast, very steep approach, no engines, you've got to get it right first time. It really is like trying to fly a brick. The thing flies very, very fast, and it's very unforgiving. But Steve did a beautiful landing, and he didn't even jog my coffee on the mid-deck. It's okay to land. It's just fantastic. And also, he didn't roll off the end of the runway into the pond full of alligators, which is, would also have been bad. We used a tail chute, not only slows us down, but also slows the rate at which we get nose slapped down of the nose gear. So it does two things for us. And then we cruise to a halt in front of our families, which is nice. They get to watch the landing. We're about 3 miles away from where we launched, which is terrific because that's where I left my toothbrush and clothes. And after about an hour of checks and things, we get out and we're all holding each other up because we haven't got our land legs back. But that's the crew. 7 went up, 6 came down. And that's the end of the video. Now. I'm going to take some questions and answers, but while that's going on, I need some help here from Leonie. Leonie? Ah. So while you're thinking of your questions, I'm going to brief Leonie on her task. You got any rings or watches?
No.
Okay, here you come. All right. Practical exercise.
Hello?
Practical exercise for you. You're going to be a spacewalker. I'm going to interview for you for spacewalking classes. You like to put your gloves on? Okay, first question. Anyone got a question?
What's the purpose of the gallon of water, salt water you have to drink?
Oh, yeah. When you go up into space, all the blood that pulls down in your legs and lower body comes flying up, and you get this big fat face. And then you can put the gloves on. And your body senses it's got too much blood volume because the blood volume sensors are in your upper body. So you just urinated out. You lose about 15% of your blood volume. And you're perfectly comfortable on orbit. However, if you come down without that, you know, depleted blood volume, you'll pass out. So what we do is we wear a G-suit that compresses our legs and drink a lot of salt water just before we come down. And I drank all this stuff and thought, this is going to be bad. But as soon as you land, you're thirsty. It doesn't go anywhere. It goes straight back into your blood. Okay? Next question. Madam.
What does it feel like when you're floating around?
It feels very strange. When you're in your spacesuit, you barely touch the sides of your spacesuit. It's very, very comfortable. And the sensation of just hanging on a handrail below the space station and watching the whole world fly by underneath and being able to move just with your fingertips, it's very, very strange. How does that feel?
It's really tight.
Right? It's tight, it's difficult to move your hands.
Yeah.
It's difficult to grip my hand. Come on. Yeah, see, it's difficult to get a strong grip. When they're pressurized, they're even more difficult to work with. Okay, so while I'm answering questions, you get to do the work. I'd like to tie up my shoelace. So. Next question. Sir.
What made you want to be an astronaut?
Oh, it's a steady job and it's got a great health plan. I always wanted to be an astronaut. Since I was about your age, man. I mean, I love the space program, I love science, and I had great teachers at school. She's doing good. I had great teachers at school who kept my interest in science going. So I always wanted to be an astronaut. Sir?
Are you just oblivious of the dangers when you're there, you know, when everything is orange outside, you just
No, never oblivious. Keep going. You're never oblivious to the dangers. Space flight's a risky business. On a mission, about 60 to 70% of the risk is in the launch. About 20% is in the entry. So the first 50 miles and the last 50 miles are the most dangerous. Getting there and back is dangerous. While you're in space, it's really quite safe, relatively speaking. There's not a lot that can really hurt you while you're up there. But during launch and entry, you're very, very much on your toes, ready for any emergencies. You're hired. You're hired. That's a great job. I saw this other person doing it yesterday and they took forever. That's fantastic. You're hired. Okay, you can dump your gloves now. Thanks a lot. Well done. Next question.
You said that you hoped many people here would go into space like yourself, but you and Michael Fulm and Nicholas Patrick all had to emigrate to America to become astronauts because the UK doesn't have a policy supporting a manned program. I wonder what you thought of that.
Well, it's we have 16 countries involved in the International Space Station. That's US, United States, Russia, Canada, the European countries, except for Britain, and Japan. So 16 countries altogether. I'm hoping one day that Britain will join in. It's up to the British taxpayers and British Parliament to decide when that is, but I really hope one day that the Brits will join in as full-fledged members. Next.
How important is a traditional sort of military background for astronaut training?
Well, not that important because I don't have one. We have a lot of people from the military. That's where we get our test pilots from. And that's where we get the best test pilots from, frankly, because they have to fly high-performance aircraft. So the pilots and commanders are from a military background, always. The flight engineers, some are civilian, some are military. The scientists are pretty well all civilian. And the doctors are half civilian, half military. So it's a mixed bunch. We need a range of talents. And we look for them where we can. Yes, ma'am.
You know, when you came out of the space station and you were about outside fixes, how did you feel after being outside for so many hours?
Say again.
You know, when you was in the space station, mm-hmm. and then you and another man came out and was fixing.
Yep.
Yeah. How did you feel after being outside for so many hours?
It's a good question. We you're in your suit for 10 hours. When you pull the helmet on, you know you better scratch your nose before you pull it on because it's going to be 10 hours before you can get it off. No food, little small water bag. Can't go to the bathroom. So you're out there for 10 hours and you're working hard. You're working really, really hard against the suit, as you found out with the gloves, right? Everything on the spacesuit's like that. So after 10 hours, you're pretty tired. You're ready for it's been an 18-hour or a 19-hour day by the time you come back in. You're ready for dinner and a rest. But then the commander comes and says, hey, something else needs fixing. So.
How do you wash?
Another good question. Why don't we have a shower? Water will get everywhere. What's the problem with having free water inside a space vehicle? What's the biggest threat? Electric. Who said that? You. Good for you. You're right. You don't want liquid water hitting any electrical panels. So showers are a no-no. No baths either. No jacuzzis. Terrible. You get a washcloth, like a flannel. Warm water, soap. Wash yourself all over, carefully, thoroughly. Then you get another one with just water on it, rinse yourself off, and that's it. And you keep doing that for 6 months if you live on station. And those guys say when they come back and they have a shower, it hurts their skin. They're not used to it. Yes, ma'am?
How do you
Sleeping is very hard. You feel like you're falling. When you start going to sleep, you feel like you're falling, and you watch your friends trying to go to sleep, and you see them do this. Because they're falling and they kind of catch themselves. So the trick is to get in your sleeping bag and to bunge your sleeping bag up against the wall so that, you know, you think you've got pressure against your back and you feel like you're in bed at home. But I find it difficult to sleep. I got 5 hours a night, and that was pretty average. And we use sleeping pills to help us sleep. Sir?
What do you have to do to be an astronaut?
What do you have to do to be an astronaut? Good question. You have to be something else first. Everyone who's an astronaut was something else first. And that something else first varied between being a pilot, test pilot, engineers, scientists, doctors. Those are the main categories. Everybody was one of these first before they became an astronaut. So the thing in common with all these qualifications is all these people were educated. So if you want to be an astronaut, you've got to stay at school, do something you really like, whatever you like, science, technology, engineering, whatever. But stay at it, and who knows. So,
if there are any, what's the worst aspect of
it? What's the worst aspect
yeah.
of being in space? Well, I don't think there is one. I think the food, I don't like the food too much. I have to steal the Russian food. but it's great. What can I tell you? Space flight's great. It's a lot of fun. Sir?
Of all the tasks you've been doing in the mission, what's the hardest one?
The hardest thing that I ever had to do, particular task, was when you saw me resting with the bolts on that machine that I was trying to move out of the payload bay. I had 7 attempts at it with different tools, and finally on the 7th attempt, I got it undone. I really was beginning to think I wasn't going to get it done. So that's a common experience for spacewalkers. You'll find something that just doesn't want to move, and you have to use every trick in the book to try and get the job done. Sir?
What was it like the first time you went into space?
First time I went to space, I kind of didn't know what it would feel like. And the launch just completely blew me away. I thought, my God, this is amazing. It's the first 8 minutes and I'm already... The thing settled down. First time you do a spacewalk, it's very disorienting. The sunlight is so bright, it almost blinds you. And it takes getting used to see yourself hanging underneath a ship that's flying around the world at 5 miles a second. So the sights and the sensations are very strange. But you get used to it. You do get used to it.
When you were doing the spacewalks, would it have been possible if you'd have let go? What would have happened if you'd have let go?
If you let go, don't do that. If you let go, you have a little tether, a steel wire. Okay, so in theory, you should be able to just pull yourself back on the steel wire. And a couple of guys have done that. They've fallen off and pulled themselves back. Now, if that breaks or comes unhooked, you have a small nitrogen-powered jetpack with a little hand controller, and you can jet yourself back like James Bond. There's a question there, I think. Yes, ma'am?
What was you before you came there?
I was a scientist. I worked for 15 years studying global warming using satellites and computer models, and I love science, and I'm still interested in it, and I talk to my friends every day about it. Sir?
How do you go to toilet in space?
How do you go to toilet in space? Hey, that always comes up. Well, on the Earth, you've got gravity, right? That makes everything go where it's supposed to go. There's the toilet, here's you. That's where you want to go, and gravity assists. Well, you don't have gravity in space, so we use fans instead. And the technique is you get there and you follow the instructions, and it says turn the fan on, so everyone knows what you're doing. So there's this howling fan. Then you sit down, position yourself, open this little trap door, do whatever you've got to do, carefully close the trap door, check to see that nothing got loose, turn the fan off, clean yourself up. And if you mess this up, if you don't follow the instructions, if you're impatient, if you're hasty, then you've made a horrible free-floating mess that you get to clean up. And your friends on the crew will no longer be your friends. Sir? How many years of training? When I joined the Corps, I had 2 years basic training. That's flying in the tank, a lot of study. You have to know your systems of the space shuttle backwards and forwards. A lot of work in the simulators. That's 2 years basic that everybody gets. And then you kind of go off into specialities. I'm a spacewalker, so I did a lot of spacewalker training. That takes about another year and a half to do that. And then when you get picked for a mission, it takes a year to train at least for that particular mission. So really it takes from when you walk in the door to when you blast off about 4 years minimum. And for the two ladies on our flight, they'd been in the office 10 years, it was their first flight, so they've had to wait a long time. Sir?
After liftoff, when the tank falls, where does it go?
Where does the tank go? After you drop it at 8 minutes, it falls into the Indian Ocean. Well, actually it doesn't. The ash from the tank falls into the Indian Ocean. It re-enters. By that time, you're going 5 miles a second, so is the tank. When it hits the atmosphere, it just burns up. Sir?
There are many asteroids now, but not many missions.
We got about, we got about 14 to 16 missions left, and we got Hubble. About 17 missions to do. We've got about 100 astronauts. We have Space Station, which is going up to a 6-person crew in 2009. And we have the new vehicle coming along in 2013, we hope. So I think it's going to be plenty of work for the people who are there. Sir?
Did your body adapt differently to weightlessness on your second flight when compared to your first?
It went a little quicker. Because I think mainly because I knew what to expect and I pre-medicated. When you get to space, a few things happen. First of all, this liquid moves up, gives you congestion and a headache. So you take Motrin for that. Your back elongates quite a bit, stretches out, because you don't have the weight of your body pushing, compressing your spine every day, so your back stretches by an inch. That hurts, so you take Motrin for that. And your stomach seems to float around for the first day or so. But after 3 days, everything settles down, and 95% of people after 3 days feel good. Sir?
I know behind the scenes, things astronauts tend to have a few traditions, like a pre-launch game of cards, hearts, or even greeting messages to their families, but I know that they usually have a traditional breakfast cake with the emblem on it. What flavor of a cake is it?
What flavor? It varies. Ours was a carrot cake. And the first time we... you get to pick your own breakfast when you launch, because you never know. So the first breakfast, I said, I'll have steak and eggs planks, and orange juice. I got the full deluxe breakfast. And by the time we got to the third launch attempt, the cook said, now you're going to get what I give you. No special breakfast for you. That's right. Yes, ma'am.
What's going to happen when you finish building the International Space Station?
What's going to happen when you finish building the International Space Station? We'll finish the build about 2009, 2010. I think 2010 now. And then station will be complete. We've got to maintain it with 6 people aboard for another 10 years till 2020. It's going to last till 2020. And that's the period when we hope to get the most science and technology out of it. Sir?
Is there any procedure if somebody's taken ill or sustains an injury?
If somebody's ill on board, what do you do? We've had people ill. We have a whole medical kit. We can't quite do a heart transplant, but we can do a lot for people. We could stitch them up, and we have done, if they cut themselves. We got a lot of medications. If they're really, really sick, for example, if they're bent after a spacewalk, we would have to bring them home. Okay, somebody has asked a question.
How many space missions have you been involved?
How many space missions?
Yes.
I've done two missions to space station and 6 spacewalks.
Just for the benefit of those in the audience who find it difficult to motivate themselves to do any exercise every day, you could briefly just mention how much exercise you undertake on the station,
Station astronauts. I get all my exercise spacewalking when I'm on station, but station astronauts usually do about an hour at least a day, maybe an hour and a half a day of exercise, and they need to do that because the muscles and the bones will deteriorate if you don't do that on orbit. So yeah, they're pounding away on the treadmill, on the resistive devices and things. Sir?
We've already heard that the UK government doesn't support manned spaceflight at the moment, even though there are 8 countries that contribute to the European Astronaut Corps. They all believe in the benefit of manned spaceflight. What would you say to help influence the government the value of space?
I would say that you have to sit down and take a long, hard look at the benefits and costs of human spaceflight. And I think you'll find that all the member countries that are involved in the space station, and all the Europeans, it's been hard from time to time, and it's expensive business, but they're all glad they're in there. They're all very happy they're in there. Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering how much money would that take, though, because at the moment the British government put £78 million into the project for the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, haven't they? What's the sort of scale of money that we're talking about?
Well, I have to take your word about the CERN costs. Okay. It depends what you want to do. It depends on what level you want to be involved. So for ESA, I don't know what the budgets run at, but it's of that order, I would imagine. I would have same order, roughly. I don't know exactly. But don't forget that all those millions of dollars or pounds, where do they get spent? They get spent here. They get spent here on technical jobs, on high technology jobs that have significant benefit for the British national interest. So, you know, it's not like we're taking money and just burning it in space. Every pound would get spent in Britain on jobs for British technologists and scientists. Sir?
How do you know which part of the world to land back in?
Say again?
How do you know which part of the world to land back in?
How do you know which part of the world to land back in? Okay, you've got computers that tell you which orbit you're on and what's lying ahead of you, and you have to work out and figure out everything backwards to when to light the engines to kick you out of orbit to land. You have to do quite a lot of planning, but it works great.
What inspired you to go to space?
I've always been interested. I loved it. It's about combined science and technology in a very exciting way. I've always liked it. Yes, ma'am.
Someone cut themselves like really deeply with that, and
there
was like, they were losing blood,
and
would all the blood that float about, and then would you be able to put it back in their leg?
No. Well, we've had people cut themselves. We have to mop up the floating blood, and we can't put it back in them. We just have to throw it away, and then you stitch up the subject and, you know, bandage him up and sit him in a corner. There you go. Sir?
What period of time do you drink that gallon?
About 30 minutes. But I did mine in 10 because I was late. So I just really knocked it back. It felt, you had to force it down. Yes, ma'am.
What does it feel like when you come off of the
space shuttle?
Yeah.
What, when you land?
Yeah.
When you land, it feels terrible. It feels awful. Coming back is much worse than going up. Everything, you feel like someone's put two bags of concrete on your shoulders, and you sort of like this, you know, feel very heavy. And also, it feels like the world's moving under your feet because your inner ear doesn't adapt, your balance organs don't adapt, so you have to be very careful as you walk around. It takes about 2 or 3 days to get better.
How does going into space affect you, like, psychologically?
Does it affect you psychologically?
Does it, like, change the way you think about the world?
Not really, in my case. I can't speak for everybody. As a scientist, I studied the Earth a lot. You know, I thought about how the Earth worked for 15 years, and it was great to get up there and see things that I had studied in theory. You know, see weather systems, see the icebergs, the ice packs, see fires over the Amazon, see the snow all over the Himalayas. It was just beautiful to see things that I knew about in theory and just see it all actually happening down there like a little machine. So it gave me an appreciation for how beautiful our planet is. It really did. But not in a sort of, you know, totally internally changing way. Just an appreciation, the way that you would appreciate anything beautiful. So,
do you think it's a shame that we're going to lose the shuttle's capabilities to carry out work on orbit
when we
start flying Orion?
Not a shame is probably the wrong word. Shuttle's been a really good workhorse for NASA, and that's what people say, workhorse. And it has. It's a very flexible vehicle. But it's very expensive to operate. It's getting very old. And it's time to retire it after we've finished the station build. Now, the next vehicle we make, Orion, is safer, a lot cheaper, and I think will get us where we want to go, which is back to the moon.
Yeah, today, I don't know if you're aware, that there's a guy up on the International Space Station, and his first job when he goes on his walk outside is not to do any real hard science.
Yeah.
It's in fact to hit a golf ball.
Right.
That's his first job outside. When you see people and that's their task, that's what they're going to do, how does that make you feel as a scientist?
You have to ask the Russian space agency about that. I'm not going to speak to it. I'm not going to speak to it, man. I'm not. Sir?
You've got a major solar flare out in space.
what can you do in the space station? Is there a really well-protected part of the space station if you go to?
There's some parts are better protected than others. Back in the service module, we have water tanks around the hull, and that's better protected. If it got really bad, the crew would get it, jump into a Soyuz and deorbit, and they'd be home in about 4 hours.
What's the most hardest part of the spatial or the space station to prepare?
The hardest part? Well, it turns out there are two big devices that are connected to the cooling system on the space station that are enormous. They're the size of a couple of big freezers bolted together. And we know they're both going to fail at some point during the future history of station, and they will have to be changed out. And I personally think that's going to be really interesting when we get around to doing that. Sir?
How self-sufficient is the space station in terms of food and recycling?
No recycling of water, though we're working on that. There's a couple of devices the Russians want to do to recycle the condensate water and use it to make oxygen, and same with urine. Food, we eat the food and we throw away the trash.
So there's no growing?
No. Well, we've got a little plant experiment, which is like $1 million worth of spinach here growing in this tank. And if you were to just go, oh, look at that. I think you'd make some scientist really mad. Yes, ma'am.
Do I get paid?
Yeah, I get paid. Get paid. Scientists and engineers get paid quite well.
I'm not telling you.
I'm a civil servant, I can't tell you that. You're all the way back, sir. But quite well, quite well.
It seems like you've got a very busy day and you're not getting a lot of sleep and you've got a long week. I'm interested in a sort of project management sense, and having to deal with everything that you have to deal with is quite hard on you to kind of...
Yeah, we are the absolute nuts, and so are mission control for checklists. We program the day down to the minute. And the trouble is, as soon as you get out of bed, even if you get out early, you're already behind. And we have our days absolutely crammed with activities, so we're going flat out. So you find yourself working through your meals, then you find yourself working through pre-sleep, and then you find yourself working into your sleep. So, like I said, I got 5 hours sleep a night. Sir?
Any kind of support a medical professional or a flight doctor on the ISS?
Yeah, sure. We have doctors. We have we have a couple of MDs who are training for station crews. And we're really hoping to use them for experiments, you know, to direct the experiments on orbit. Yeah, not for them, for sure. Okay. You've asked a lot of questions, but this is your last question, sir. I'm telling you, I'm watching.
While you're inside the space shuttle, what's harder, launching from into space or landing on Earth?
Launch is very tough psychologically. You know, you've usually been waiting for months for it. There's always launch delays. You're ready to go. You're tired after 2 years of training. You want to go. But when you actually get to go, it's great. Very exciting. Sir?
You've changed locations for me 15 years in the previous occupation to apply to be an astronaut.
I mean,
if you had 15 years in the previous occupation, would there be
another
age limit?
Yeah, when you're applying, I'm extremely old, which is in a very polite way. That's okay. when I've hung up my space boots, I'm going to go back to science.
No, I mean, from your previous career,
yeah.
After doing 15 years in one job,
Oh, when I applied, I was 41 when I joined. Another guy joined the same class as me, he's 45. And he's 53 now, and he's just finished a station, 6 month station here, John Phillips. Great guy. And you know, it's really health determined and energy determined more than anything. Some people just kind of run out of energy. And the age at which that happens is variable. We must be coming at the last questions, but you, sir.
What gases does the shuttle emit as it leaves?
What gases does the shuttle emit as it goes up? The engines for shuttle are hydrogen and oxygen, which when they combine produce water. So we leave a big steam plume behind us. The solid rocket boosters are a perchlorate mixture, and they spew out all sorts of stuff, but it rains out pretty quickly. Yes, ma'am.
Do you not worry about all the air pollutants that the rocket creates?
No. Because I'm not there. I'm not there anymore. I'm away. No, the pollution caused by rocket launches is very, very, very small. And you know, when we get to Orion, it'll be almost nothing.
When the shuttle launches, it creates a hole in the atmosphere. Are you worried as a scientist, is there anything that is caused by that? Is there any way to avoid that?
Avoid what, sorry?
When the shuttle
launches,
it creates like a hole in the atmosphere?
No. Well, if it fills in behind it, it's just like an aeroplane. Just make a hole in the air and the air fills in behind you, just like an aeroplane. There's no lasting hole.
What next for you?
Well, more questions, and then back to Houston, I'm instructing. This is a typical kind of thing that, you know, I was going to say senior, but older guys get to do. I instruct a lot, spacewalking in particular, help out with the program, helping out with thinking how we're going to organize a 6-person crew. And assist with missions. There's a mission coming up in December, so I'll be helping out supporting the spacewalking on that. So they keep us very busy.
Another mission for you?
Well, if they ask me, yes, always. I mean, yeah, always say yes, but there's a long line of people ahead of me, and some of them haven't flown, so I defer to them first. Everyone's got to have a chance. I've been lucky. Yes, ma'am.
I just wondered what sort of precautions you take or the crew takes when you go up in space, because obviously you're exposed to high levels of radiation. And is there any kind of monitoring of that when you come back?
Sure. We take dosimeters up with us, radiation dosimeters, so we know exactly how much radiation we've taken. We wear a dosimeter. And you know what? It's about 2 chest x-rays a day worth. That's what the radiation dose is, so it's nothing terrible. And we haven't seen any trends of things you expect, like soft tissue cancers or blood cancers as a result of exposure to radiation, even the long-term crews. So not so much of a bother. Now, it will be more of a bother when we go outside the Van Allen belts and through the Van Allen belts and outside into interplanetary space. The radiation load is higher, and we'll have to fix that. Not the radiation, but the shielding. What I'm going to do now is I got a couple of Christmas gifts. Yeah.
Goodies.
Well, I mean, somebody could try messing with that while I'm doing this, but first of all, British Interplanetary Society for being so nice and inviting me here. Some time ago, they sent me a flag to fly in space, and we did. And I wish I had it with me. Okay. And Leone, I think, has been designated to receive this, that's right, on behalf of British Interplanetary Society. So come on up. Let me show you what you got. Okay, here we go. This is the little flag. It flew in space with us. It's signed by everybody on the crew. And it says, flown on SCS-121. All the crew's names there. This patch was also flown, and we've glued it all to a nice series of pictures that Lisa and Stephanie put together, showing our shuttle launch with all the 4th of July fireworks in the background that weren't really there. But it's a nice piece of art, and that's for you guys. Thanks very much. You could try copying the whole file onto the hard drive and then play it from there, maybe. I could take a couple more questions while waiting. John?
Let me receive that from this young lady.
Oh, okay, you get to do that. Now you're going to make sure she doesn't take it home, is that right?
That's right. The boss has said.
Well, thanks very much for inviting me. I think there's a couple of other things here. John, you might want to stick around.
The goodie bag gets bigger.
Yeah, I know. The goodie bag. What's this? Here's my nice letter from the British Interplanetary Society. And here's the 2 that didn't get flown. I thought I'd be honest and flown.
There you go. So back into store. So
I think you should give them to the next guy who goes.
Great and stuff.
There you go.
Very much.
You're welcome.
Great stuff.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Take it easy. So if we have time, or what, we run out of time.
One thing back, Piers, actually.
Okay.
I think we're strangers bringing gifts.
Not that strange.
You have to be enrolled. You've just got to be enrolled.
This sounds like a way to get money out of it. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome.
I'm enrolled.
And there's one other item here.
That's very nice.
That I want you to,
John,
to
Suzanne.
Promise that you will test out as soon as you possibly can for form, fit and function. Do you want to look at what it is?
Yeah, sure.
You better show people if you can take that lid off. You've got to test drive it, okay? As soon as possible.
I got a British Interplanetary mug. Yes, excellent. Thank you. That's great. What's this?
That's a little emblem for you.
Oh, yeah, fabulous. I got BIS memorabilia. That's lovely.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. That's great.
Good stuff. So, next time you get a chance to put some beer in it, do so.
It won't be long.
Yes.
It won't be long. Thanks a lot. I don't want to forget any of this. Yeah.
Richard Branson, Virgin Galactic, and the Burt Rutan project. Do you see them coming on board more with the international kind of space effort that fits in with NASA and the European Space Agency, or do you see them just doing their own thing and never the time she'll make it?
I think they're a space tourism outfit, and that's great because I think there's a healthy future in space tourism, and it should be handled by the private sector. It shouldn't be handled by governments. Governments are not in the tourism business. Just a cautionary note there, what was done for the X Prize, which was quite an achievement, a lob up into the atmosphere and down again, the energy required to do that per pound launched is 1/50th of the energy required to get into orbit. It's a lot harder to get into orbit. And then you have to get rid of that energy when you come back. So this is a great step, but they've got a long way to go before you see Prize in orbit. It's working? You think it's working? Well, I'll stay here until I see it actually working. They're going to make him press the button. Watch this. Seven seconds. Hey.
Sure.
that's it. I'm done. I got one closing statement and then I'll shut up completely, John. Sorry.
No problem. Lights, please. Do you want to make that now? Or?
I'll make it now. Okay. If you don't mind, then you've got the floor. This is really for all of you guys, students and school kids out there. I owe an enormous debt to my teachers who kept me interested even when I wasn't at school. It was hard, you know, as a teenager to pay attention to some of the things my teachers were trying to tell me. However, hang in there, keep studying, and careers in science and technology and engineering can be very, very exciting and rewarding, can take you anywhere in the world and do anything you like. I still like to go to work. I really do, every day. So I just advise you, listen to your teachers and stick at it. Education is very important. End of lecture.